Sorry. My name is Erica Imrani, and I'm a senior editor with Harlequin's Mira imprint. And I've had the real privilege to be Jason Mott's editor, and I'm thrilled to be here today to talk to him about his extraordinary debut novel, The Returned. So Jason, welcome.
Thank you.
For people who aren't familiar with the novel, can you tell us a little bit about what it's about?
Sure, I definitely can. The novel centers around this global event in which people's loved ones are returning from death. It basically follows the path of this couple who's in their 70s, and 50 years ago, their 8-year-old son drowned on his birthday. So they go to the door one day in contemporary time, and they're 70 years old now, and their 8-year-old son is at the door, still 8 years old. So that basically sums up the premise. It's this global event in which people's loved ones are coming back, and different people are reacting to it in very different ways, and it kind of takes place in this very small southern town, and the town is really forced to see which side of the fence they choose to follow on in terms of this huge event that's happening.
So I know when people hear about novels about people coming back from the dead, they immediately think zombies, but that's not what this novel is. So can you clarify a little bit about what this, you know, if it's not a zombie novel, what is it?
Sure thing. Yeah, that is one thing we do get, like, is it a zombie novel? It is completely not that. To kind of give a little background about what the novel is about, I'll explain basically where it came from. Both of my parents have passed away, my mother in 2001 and my father in 2007. So in the summer of 2010, I had this dream that I came home from work and found my mother sitting at the kitchen table waiting for me. So I came in and sat down with her, and we just sat and talked about all the things that have happened in the last decade since her passing away. And it was this really warm, cathartic dream where I got to talk to my mother again for the first time in a decade. And I told her about going to grad school, about wanting to become a writer, all these new friends that I met since she'd actually passed away. And it just helped me get through a lot of things that I've been carrying since her death that I probably didn't even realize I was carrying at all at the time. And when I woke up from that dream the next morning, it stuck with me. It was this really vivid dream where I kind of expected to find her sitting at the kitchen table waiting for me. And I wanted to cling to that. Like, that dream stayed with me for weeks. And I was talking to a really good friend about, you know, writing and about this dream that I'd had. He said, you know, well, can you really imagine if that actually happened? And what if it wasn't just her? So that was really the start of things. I wrote a short story based off of that dream. And then the short story went over really well at a reading that I did. Like, people responded to it really strongly. So after that, I started a manuscript. And a couple years later, here we are.
Well, the book has been getting amazing buzz. It's gotten starred reviews in Publishers Weekly and Kirkus and Booklist. It got a rave in Entertainment Weekly just recently, which was really exciting. Endorsements from Douglas Preston and Amy Bender. So, I mean, it's been kind of amazing. So how does it feel to have your work received in this kind of way? And your first novel, no less.
It feels really good. I think every writer obviously wants to have the big first novel happen and have this rave reviews happening. And every time something really good happens, it's a huge amount of disbelief. I think even now, there's still just day-to-day disbelief where I don't really think any of this is real at all. I tell people, you know, a year ago, I was answering phones at Verizon Wireless, and now a year later, here we are. You know, I've got this novel that's coming out, and it's getting good reviews, and I'm here at BEA. You know, the novel's been picked up by ABC to become a television series. It's just been such a, you know, amazing whirlwind ride this past year.
Yeah, so I was going to ask you, what's been the journey been like? How has your life changed?
Just a lot busier right now, I think. Everything is full steam ahead right now. There's always something to do. The television thing is a really big talking point right now. Everyone wants to know what's happening with that. And luckily, I don't have any heavy lifting to do with that. I've got a great team working on that. So right now, I'm working on the next novel. I've got another manuscript that's kind of being worked on, as you well know.
Yes.
And there's just, it's a lot of work right now, but a lot of fun. I'm having the time of my life, quite frankly.
So I know when I first read The Returned, what struck me the most was how personal it is. I immediately thought about people who had passed in my own life. I had an uncle who died when I was only 13, and he was really special to me. And even still, I don't know, 20 years later almost, you know, I still think about what it would be like if he was still here. And the book just sort of brought those emotions to life for me in a really intimate kind of way. And I guess if there's one thing you want readers to take away from this novel, what is that?
I think that in the ideal world, I think I see readers, I hope that readers will come to the novel, they'll sit down, they'll read it, and once they finish it, they close the novel, go to the closet, dig out that old photo album, and just really sit and remember someone that they've known and they've loved and cared about that's passed away. I think that when we lose someone, memories are all we really eventually have. And I think it's really cool if I can impart to someone that they stop for a moment of their busy day, because we all get so busy nowadays. If I can get someone to stop for a moment and, you know, pull out a photo album, remember someone that they've lost, remember something that happened that makes them feel good, I think that the novel succeeded in every way that I could hope for if that happens.
So those were all of my questions. That went really quickly. I'd love to take some questions from the audience.
Sure, I think he's got a microphone for you.
Hi. I'm interested in what the real focus is that's going to make me excited to read it. I mean, what is it about what you've got to say that is going to really draw me in?
Well, I think it explores a lot of the issues that we have with death and the coping that happens with death and how we change after a death occurs in our lives. A lot of the conflict that the characters in the novel come across is the fact that they're not who they were at the time that this loved one departed from their lives. As much as I love my mother, and I dearly love her still, I'm not the same person I was a decade ago. If she showed up at the front door today, just as she was a decade ago, here I am, an entirely different person. You know, I was 22 when she passed away. I'm almost 35 now. Just think of the changes that occurred to us in that very formative period of our lives. So if her and I sat down now and had certain discussions about things, how would those discussions really go? And the novel tries to treat everything as realistically as possible, which is where the conflict arises. When I was working on the manuscript, I had a lot of friends and family members that I sat and talked with. And I asked everyone, I said, if someone that you lost suddenly returned, how would you feel about it? And the initial reaction is always elation. They're always just so excited. They say, I would love to sit down with, you know, my mother or this person that I cared about and spend some time with them. And once you get past that initial conversation, I would say, okay, imagine it's 6 years, six months now, and this person that you lost is still back. How is your life? How do you feel about it now? And then the answers got really complicated because people would say, well, I'm a little bit different now. Like I used to feel this way about politics, and now if my dad came back, him and I would be completely opposed to how we feel about certain things that are happening. You know, they're doing things in their lives now that their parents may not have approved of, or, you know, they're different people. And that's really what the novel tries to explore is, once a death has occurred and we've moved on, how much of us has actually moved on?
So would you say your book is plot-driven or character-driven?
Hopefully it's both. I'm a big fan of character-driven novels, but I'm also a big fan of plots. You have to have a story to move the characters along. I always try to say that plot is the sandbox that the characters play in, and you have to make sure you have both of those really sound, really strongly built in order to have a good novel. So there are characters there, they're going through a lot of emotion, but the plot is there as well. It's this really small town, and as this event grows, the people in that town begin taking sides. Some people don't believe that these are their loved ones returning. They think of them as abominations. You know, they buried their mother a decade ago, and this thing sitting in front of them is not their parents or not whoever they cared about. So the town begins to pick sides, and it starts to just grow and gets a little bit darker at certain times. So hopefully it's both character and plot driven.
So did the novel that you're working on now start with a dream?
Well, actually, not really. The novel I'm working on now started with me, a very good friend of mine, the same one that kind of got me writing this novel. I've known him now for almost a decade, and when I met him, it was in college. And college friends are really wild, crazy friends. They drink a lot, they party a lot. They're just insane people. And now he's married with two kids, two wonderful children, and he's 100%, he's one of the best dads I've ever come across. So watching him change over that time has just been really, really exciting for me. So this new project that I'm working on is centered around a father and daughter, and a lot of the changes that have occurred since this father's become a parent. So my friend is inspired by the new project. Cool. What other questions? Any others? No? Okay.
Jason, I had one. Just because being here for the presentations, I saw a couple other Harlequin authors. You grew up wanting to be an author as a profession, or you wanted to be something else and came to it?
No, I grew up wanting to write, never thinking that I would actually be able to do it. I got excited about writing when I was about 14. During my childhood, I grew up reading the Odyssey and the Iliad and Beowulf, all those epic heroic tales. And then I ran out of them. I lived in a very small town. The internet wasn't around, so I couldn't just Google, you know, the stories I wanted to find. And then one day I found this novel called Grendel by a writer named John Gardner, which is the story of Beowulf told from the alternative perspective, told from the monster's point of view. And I didn't know that you were allowed to take pre-existing stories and make them your own and really create this whole new mythos out of them. And that inspired me to start writing. I started writing small versions of the Odyssey with like other stories, you know, things they were doing when they weren't in Troy. So it was just, that was the license that made me want to start writing, and it's been going ever since. Any others? No, one here.
I've done nonfiction writing, but fiction writing I always thought was really difficult for me because I need something tangible to put things on. Mm-hmm. How do you do your research for the two novels that, you know, the one you've done, the Returned and this new one? What kind of research goes into that?
A lot of it is regional research. I live in the South in a very small town in North Carolina. The current project takes place in the town based off of the town that I live in. The next project takes place in North Carolina as well. So a lot of my time is spent just really researching the landscape, the local language, the local people. Southern towns, small towns in particular, have a lot of deep-rooted backstories. So I always try to go and visit and just sit with people. And just normal small town conversation can give you droves of information that you want to use for stories and for writing purposes. And apart from that, researching for fiction is very much akin to researching for nonfiction. You find factual things that have happened and put a slight twist on them and make them your own, I think. Oh, sure. The question was, did I have a teacher who really influenced me? Yes, I've had several. One of my major writing instructors was a guy named Philip Girard, who still teaches at UNC Wilmington, where I went and got my graduate degree.
What university?
Oh, I'm sorry, University of North Carolina, Wilmington. That's where I went for an undergrad in fiction and a graduate in poetry. And Philip Girard really helped instill in me the writing mentality of you wake up every day and you write and you treat it as a job. And if you get really lucky and you're really fortunate, it may actually become a job. So he was one that still influences me today. He's been a bit of a mentor, and he's still a bit of a mentor.
Jason, you just mentioned that you went to school for poetry. Can you tell us a little bit more about that and how your poetry informs your fiction and how you made that transition?
Sure thing. Poetry became my second love. I started off loving fiction, and in around my 20s, I fell in love with poetry. And the two, I tend to swing back and forth between the two. They tend to inform one another. The poetry winds up being very narrative driven, it follows a certain thread. I'm a big fan of those epic poems of the past that follow a big arc. So I try to do the same thing with my current poetry. And the fiction, the poetry sometimes bleeds over. If I want to achieve a lot in a very small space, poetry is really good for teaching you how to do that. Cool, thank you all for having me.